was a time before you, and there will be a time after you. Though these bodies are not our own, walk tall, little one. Walk tall.
I have to say, Ryan, the far superior potato chip is salt and vinegar.
I would agree with that, but I would say it has to be the kettle cooked salt and vinegar.
Well, that's just a bunch of bullshit. What does kettle cooked even fucking mean?
It means that it's cooked in a kettle, Mike. It doesn't mean that it was cooked in like an
You're telling me this company separates their chips? No, they just, I bet they like fucking put it in the oven longer. Like, it's not made in that kettle. That can't be real.
Do you see that shit? It's got curves on it like a fucking black woman. Like, it's got...
Chips have curves like a Latina.
Like, there ain't... Like, there's no ripples or anything like that. Like, it's, like, a curvy chip, and it's, like... It just tastes different. It's more, like, authentic.
There is something about the processed taste of Lay's salt and vinegar that drives me crazy.
I don't fuck with Lay's.
Really?
I don't know. I just...
You're telling me you like the Kettle One salt and vinegar ones most?
Mm-hmm. Like Cape Cod. I don't know if they have that in Oregon.
They don't, but I've had Cape Cod before.
Oh, it's fire.
It's
so good.
Great.
I can't eat more than like one bag because like my mouth will get all raw. Like I just ate a bunch of Warheads. Ugh. But like one bag's good enough.
So good though. They're too good. Too good.
You are tuned into Northwest by Northeast. My name is Ryan Martin.
And I'm Michael Bayless.
And we are going to be talking everything from politics to music to film to TV. Mike, what do you got on your mind?
Well, something new this week that me and Ryan are doing is we're going to lead into our podcast with a little song, part of a song. And we decided to play Baby Boy this week, Childish Gambino. You just heard it.
Off the new album, Awaken My Love.
And you can find a review for that on our blog, Music Time with Mike and Rye, done by us two handsome devils. But Ryan, we'll start with you since you wrote the article. What did you think about it?
Well, I go very in depth. I could try and analyze each song differently with the new album. But I personally loved it. It was just a really like crazy experience, and I really like the production on it a lot. The only like drawback to the album is I really don't care for the vocal distortion. Songs like California and Have Some Love kind of demonstrate these the best. But it's just too funky for me. And I actually heard in an interview with and funky isn't a bad way.
It's too much funk.
Turn down the funk. I heard in an interview that Gambino said that he didn't use any vocal distortion on the album. It was all just him singing in a different way. So that was pretty interesting to me.
There's no vocal distortion?
I guess not. I definitely hear auto-tune on songs like Stand Tall.
Yeah, I for sure thought I heard something like that. That's interesting. Well, now I've got to listen to it again.
Mike, what'd you think of the album?
I enjoyed it, but you know, we're biased people.
We are.
Because I'm a huge Donald Glover fan. Like, whatever he does, whatever he puts his name on, like, I'll fucking buy it. Fuck, you know? Like, because the internet camp, Kwai, fucking Stone Mountain mixtape, all the mixtapes way back when, to even back to like...
I'm not a rapper.
Yeah, those are some... When he's rapping over Grizzly Bear.
Yeah, like indie rock samples and stuff.
Yeah, that's what like made him different, I guess. But now he's fucking made a funk album, and I love it.
What would you compare to Awaken My Love to, like, Because the Internet and Camp and stuff?
Well, I was watching this interview with him, and he said, like, I don't make albums, which sounded so douchey when I first heard it. But he started to explain himself, and he was like, each one is just like a moment in life or something, and it's like it was something really profound. I feel like we should play it like a snippet from it.
Why did you start working on this album?
I don't believe in albums. I don't want to do albums. No, I don't. I really don't. And I know that sounds like really lame and I think pretentious and kind of like gross and just like I don't do albums. But I don't want to do albums, especially now. If you're gonna put out a body of work, it should be like an experience. That's like, cause we can do. It's easy to do that now. Like, it's so. Like, I don't think Kanye puts out records. Like, he puts out, like, whole things. Like, there's projections, and there's this show that goes with it, and there's this booklet that goes with it. And it's like, it's I want to make, like, worlds and stories that people can live in for, like, years if they want.
So I thought Awaken My Love was a really good transition. You know, I feel like every album he's done is like really different. Every project he's done is like really different. While he does still keep like, you know, his vocals and his like lyricism, because he still is writing on it, you know.
Right.
So I mean, he's just a really gifted writer, and this just shows that if you can write well, you can really do anything.
He also said in the same interview that I was referring to that he said the making of the album wasn't fun. You know, it was a lot of work, and they made the album in this like house called The Factory, which him and his team Royalty call it, and they would write episodes for Atlanta during the day, and then they would create the music for Awaken My Love at night. And you know, that seems like a lot of work, especially for someone who just had a kid, just had, you know, a lot going on. He's got a critically acclaimed TV show that he's been working on for about 3 years now. He said that, you know, the album was just a lot of work. And you can really hear it in the music, how much effort was put in. Just layers on layers of music.
It's crazy. The funk, the soul, everything. It's like iTunes categorizes it as, like, R&B and soul. And, like, it's just, it's way more than that, I feel like.
It's funk.
Funk, soul, it's everything, man.
Everyone says a lot of, like, everyone says that you can really hear, like, elements of, like, Funkadelic and George Clinton.
Yeah, I totally.
I was listening to Maggot Brain today. Have you heard that album?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a great album. It's a great and I heard a lot of comparisons to Gambino. Like, the first opening track, that 10-minute, like, you know, mind-melting guitar solo. Like,
that shit.
It just kind of reminded me of, the, like, the solo at the end of Zombies.
Funk music is such a heavy influencer of hip-hop.
It really is. You can hear it on, like, Kendrick's To Pimp a Butterfly or...
Yeah, King Kunta, that's got P-Funk influences, G-Funk influences. Like, California on Awaken My Love, that's got a bunch of P-Funk and G-Funk influence.
Did you like that song?
California? I just thought it was hilarious.
Really?
Yeah. Like, the voice thing, like, I get why it turns people off, but, like, for some reason, like, the music was just more important to me in that song. I don't know why. Like the music behind it was just way more better than the lyrics, so I just chose to...
The production on that album is just A1 front to back.
I think it's just great, man. Like, I can't believe that he fucking wrote Atlanta and fucking made this album at the same time.
I can't either. It blows my mind still.
It's baffling.
We have a bunch of rap albums coming out still at the end of December. Oh, 2016 yeah. Still has a bunch of gas left in it.
There's still so much great music left.
Oh, totally. J. Cole's new album comes out Friday, December 9th. It'll probably have already come out by the time this podcast is released. And then we have Cudi's album coming... I want to say the following week, or maybe 2 weeks from that, this Friday, December 16th. Mike, how you feeling about it?
Oh, God. That's going to be great. I'm so excited. It's his return, man. It's like his, he's coming back. He's making a comeback.
It's his comeback album.
It's his comeback album. Hey, I think it's going to be good. I think it's going to be a good representation of, like, the music he wants to make. And I think it's going to be, because, I mean, Speeding Bullet to Heaven was just completely different. And that's what he wanted to do, you know? So now he's back on track. Good for Cudi, you know? He went to rehab. He probably did so many drugs before, like, making this album.
This album, Passion Pain?
He probably did all the drugs right before he went... Because he about to release it before he went to rehab.
Oh, that's right.
I bet he did so many fucking drugs.
Well, he's a pretty unstable force if you hear a lot of, like, the stuff going on in the news. Like, I remember hearing this, like, story back in, like, May or something about how he, like, texted, like, the mother of his daughter. Like,
oh, yeah.
Over 200 times. Because he, like, couldn't see her or something like that.
I mean...
He's a wild dude,
but he didn't do get to see his daughter, man. Like, that's his daughter.
Yeah, but I mean, like, that might be one of the driving forces behind, like, why he went to rehab and why he's so depressed and stuff.
I'm just glad he's working on himself. Well, speaking of rehab, though, Kanye West, should he go to a place like that, rehab?
I think Kanye's losing his mind. There's been rumors that Kim is going to divorce Kanye, and I think if she does, he's going to lose his mind. Like, he's not coming back.
I don't know. He could make some pretty fire music. Or he could kill himself.
I just think, like, you know, when Kanye's mom died, like, it sent him into a tailspin. You know, he created 808s, and then, like, it was kind of panned at the time, but, like, then went on to create, like, a whole different hip-hop genre in itself.
He really did.
You know, which is impressive. But, I mean, you know, now he's got, like, his wife might be leaving him. Like, he's got his kids
you
with
think,
him.
You think, like, she would take both kids? Because the whole big thing about their names... is they have to say West at the end.
Right.
Like, come on. His name is Saint West. You can't name your son Saint Kardashian. That just sounds stupid. Saint West is a dope name. Northwest? North Kardashian? Come on. Northwest sounds dumb, but it's better than North Kardashian.
Anything Kardashian just sounds like a big fucking pile of shit. Like, I'm gonna start using that name to, like, reference my poops. Like, I'm like, dude, I just took a crazy good Kardashian.
Did you see the Chloe in there earlier, man?
I just fucking Kendalled so hard.
Man, I just took a Kim K all over the floor.
So you've told me that you're a J. Cole fan, Mike. Is that right?
J. Cole's great. I don't know why people don't like him.
Did you really get into him around 2014, or was it before that?
I knew about him when he was coming. He came out with that song with Drake. It was, Can I Hit It in the Morning? I knew about him then.
Yeah.
I fucked with that album.
Wow, that's bit. Cole World, yeah.
But I didn't listen to Born Sinner, really. I didn't get back into Forest Hills Drive.
Yeah, I really liked Forest Hills Drive. I revisited, like, some of his earlier stuff, like Cold World and Born Sinner. Mm-hmm. I didn't fuck with it as hard, but
I feel like it's taken him a while to, like, really get comfortable in the way he makes music, you know?
Yeah, I feel like he's actually making, like, the music that he wants to make now, and he's putting out a new album December 9th called For Your Eyes Only.
Yeah, I'm fucking stoked for that.
I watched the documentary behind it, and
On YouTube?
Yeah, the one that, like, on Tidal.
Eyes?
Have you seen that?
What is it called?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's on YouTube, too.
Yeah, it's called Eyes. He has this one really dope quote where he says, you know, where basically he's at the point of his, like, the height of his career right now, and he can either go up or he can go down from here. There's really no in-between. Like, he can't really stay at this point forever. So he's like, well, I'm at the height of my career right now. I might as well say, like, the most real shit I can while I'm here.
He was saying real shit, man. False prophets and everybody dies.
Oh, yeah, false prophets.
He fucks people up on both songs. Like, he fucks Ye. He fucks Lil Yachty's ass up. Oh, my God.
Lil Yachty's such an easy target.
Lil Yachty makes pleasing music, but that man is so easy to make fun of because he is a meme. You can't make fun of J. Cole. J. Cole is 6'4". He's got dreads. I bet he could drop Lil Yachty's ass in a minute. Ugh. But yeah, I'm so excited for new J. Cole music. And it's coming out of nowhere. Like, I haven't heard any hype about it till, like, this month.
I think what's really, really, really fucking cool is that the two tracks that he released aren't even on the album. Like,
what?
Yeah, like, nobody has any idea what to expect. Like, there's no singles. Yeah, there's no singles. Like, he just drops two fucking hard.
What a savage.
Yeah, he drops two of the hardest fucking songs of the year. And, like,
That makes it even better. That makes the insults even better.
I think it'd be cooler if he just released those two songs out of nowhere, and then the album comes out. Like if there was no pre-order or anything like that, I think that'd be fucking tight.
Because, like, now he's making music by himself, you know? He's like, no features. It's just me and the beat I made with my homies and the hot bars.
You don't even really need features for a J. Cole album.
No. I don't think a lot of people need features. I just think they do it because, you know, get some more money in the end.
I really appreciate it when an artist comes out with, like, a debut album or something like that. Especially a debut album, and there's no features on it. Because it's kind of like a statement that's like, here I am, this is who I am as an artist. If you fuck with me, then great. You know, I'm going to make more music in the future.
I hear that.
Like, I know you don't fuck with him, but I don't really fuck with him at this point either. But when Logic came out with his first album, he did that.
He had no features?
He had no features on his first album. Except for, like, the bonus tracks.
Yeah, but, like, Anderson .Paak, receiving a lot of acclaim, got Grammy nominations, best new artist, best, like, some kind of weird genre of music album. I don't fucking remember. It's like urban contemporary. Yeah, urban contemporary. Like, what does that even mean? It's just, that's pretty much just saying it's black music. Like,
yeah, because that's what Frank Ocean won back in, like, 2013.
Exactly.
2012.
Anyway, so he had features, though, and, you know, like, these are decent features to me. And it's still a really good album, but it's not heavily featured.
I personally couldn't really get into Malibu. I don't really like his voice really? That much. Just like,
I like Anderson .Paak.
I appreciate him. I think he's a pretty, like, talented, creative artist. But I've listened to Malibu, and I just, like, it didn't stick with me. I really liked the song with Q, but, I mean, like, that was the extent of it.
It was a good one. No, the first two songs got me, and I just was hooked on it. I hope he wins Best New Artist, but it's probably going to be Chance the Rapper, even though he's not, like, new. I mean, it makes sense he's nominated to be a Best New Artist because he hasn't been nominated before, but let's be real, Academy. You knew who the fuck Chance the Rapper was.
I find it interesting that Chance the Rapper was the one that, like, opened this, like, gate of, like, possibilities for, like, artists who, like, created or released, like, just streaming-only albums to be nominated for Grammys, and he's, like, the only one besides him and Kanye who got nominated for just streaming albums.
Well, Frank Ocean definitely would have got nominated too, but that's a whole other story.
Yeah. Blonde was one of my favorite albums. So good.
Oh, yeah, by far. If that should win everything.
I'm pissed that Views is up for album of the year.
It's because it made money. And it's like heavily popular, so it's got one dance on it and Controller.
Yeah, I was actually explaining this to like my roommate Ethan, and like it makes sense why Views is so popular. I mean, it's got One Dance, which is his biggest single ever.
Its cover is a meme.
Yeah, the cover's a meme. Control is big. Hype is a fucking banger. It's got Rihanna on it. It's got Child's Play, which is a Metro Boomin banger. Like, it's got Future on it. I'm still fucking salty that Summer 16 was cut from Views and Hotline Bling was put on there as a bonus track. It makes me mad to this day.
Hotline Bling is a bonus track for Views?
Yeah, you didn't know that?
Why would that need to be a bonus track for Views?
Because he made so much money off of it as a single that by republishing it as another single on Views, it allows for double, the purchases.
He's just being smart as hell.
Oh, it's so smart, but it's, such a, cringy move, because, you see it, and you're just oh, I know what you're fucking doing. Stop it.
You should put a back-to-back on it.
Back-to-back is probably one of my favorite Drake songs.
Yeah, Drake, when he's trying to diss people, he's not really the one writing it, but he can diss people on these tracks, or at least his friends who write for him can diss people.
But what's upsetting about diss tracks is, you look at back-to-back, in the generation that we're in now, and we're like, oh, shit, this is fire. There's so many cool messages. And then you, take it back, maybe 20 years, and you go listen to No Vaseline by Ice Cube, and it blows everything out of the water.
Yeah.
It's so good. He's name-checking people left and right.
He really is. I think he needs to get Taylor Swift pregnant before it's too late.
Who, Drake?
Drake's only got, two or three albums left in him, man.
Really? You believe that?
Drake is not gonna last long anymore. He'll be... By the year 2020, Drake will be on the verge of retirement.
I have to respectfully disagree. I think Drake is at the peak of his game. And he actually kind of has been since 2011.
I think we're gonna go over our memes, and we're gonna get back to real music.
I hope so.
Yeah, me too.
Drake's not that good. If you check through Drake's catalog, you'll find a couple good songs. But all of his shit is just based off commercial songs. He's a commercial item.
Then the minute he was a rapper, he was a commodity to be sold.
The thing that makes me the most mad about Drake is the fans. And that's why so many people hate on J. Cole, is because the same people that are Drake fans are J. Cole fans.
Yeah, you're right. But there are people who are J. Cole fans because they genuinely feel like he represents hip-hop in a good way. And there are people who are fans of Drake because Drake represents... Because Drake has a lot of emotion, you know? His music does have a lot of emotion behind it.
Yes, it does.
It's not good. Doesn't sound great to everybody, but it's still emotional music, nonetheless. And the same kind of emotions that people tie with Drake, they tie with the way they feel about J. Cole, you know? But saying people who like Drake are the ones who like J. Cole is kind of weird, because they're both two of the biggest hip-hop artists of our era. So saying that's like saying, yeah, I'm a fan of Kendrick, but I guess I'm also a fan of J. Cole. I'm a Kendrick fan and a J. Cole fan, but I'm not a Drake fan.
I kind of like to think that the biggest artists of our generation right now is Cole, Drake, Kendrick, and Chance.
Yeah, I'd say that. The people who are going to make the biggest imprint on the way hip-hop is heard in our generation are going to be, those four people, I think.
Yeah. I'll say that, and someone I'm talking to will just be like, oh, well, what about Kanye? Okay. It's Kanye's always been here.
Kanye's been around. He doesn't even have to, Come on.
Yeah.
Kanye's been here, brother.
Kanye's always in the background.
Kanye's the puppet master. And now he's lost his mind, so he can't control it anymore. That's rude. I can't say that. I mean, peace and love to you, Kanye. You're never going to hear this podcast, but I love you, dog.
Before we move on from Grammy nominations, I want to get one more thing out of my system.
Do it.
I am so unbelievably pissed that DJ Khaled's Major Key is nominated for Best Rap Album of the Year.
What did you just say?
I am so mad that DJ Khaled's Major Key is nominated for Best Rap Album of the Year. It fucking irks me. It burns within me. I get so mad thinking about it because there were so many good rap albums that came out this year. So many. And you put DJ Khaled up there.
Are you telling me?
In front of, like, the whole world to see. To represent hip-hop.
Ryan Lindsay Martin, are you telling me?
My middle name's not Lindsay.
Yeah, I know. I don't know your middle name. Are you telling me DJ Khaled got nominated for Best Hip-Hop Album?
That's what I'm telling you,
That's
son.
That's fucking whack, man. Ugh, the man who Snapchatted the birth of his child is nominated for a Grammy. Like, see, this is why the Grammys suck. It's because we validate music that is just so commercial. And, like, we say, here, have an award for being the biggest brand. You know? It fucking sucks.
The thing that makes me mad is the fact that DJ Khaled's name is on the project. Because he doesn't rap.
He didn't do anything.
Produce. He's literally... He's a puppeteer.
He's just a hype man.
He just gets a bunch of his famous musical friends and puts them together. And then yells his name. That's literally the extent.
DJ Khaled!
It sucks. It totally, totally sucks. Did you see Q got nominated, though?
Yeah. For the performance? Or song?
No, for Best Rap Album.
Really?
Yeah, have you seen the nominations?
And the Blank Face got nominated? I glanced at him. I don't know. I really don't pay attention to award shows anymore, man.
I don't either, but I'm interested to see who's nominated. Yeah, we got nominees for this year are Views by Drake, Coloring Book by Chance, okay. Blank Face by Schoolboy
really?
Q, Life of Pablo, Major Key by DJ Khaled, and The Anonymous Nobody by De La Soul.
I mean, like, if I want any of them to win, I want the Anonymous Nobody to win. Like, why would you not want De La Soul to win? It's like saying you don't want Jesus to win. That's like saying you don't want your mom to win. That's like saying you don't want your grandpa to live.
What the Grammys always do is they, like, fill the, like...
Oh, they fill one spot with, like, one actual really good rapper just to make people feel better.
Yeah. Yeah, they do that all the time.
Do it all the fucking time. And I'm always cheering for the person that they sneak in there just to make me feel better.
That's what they did with Anderson .Paak.
Damn it. You're right. You're so right. Ugh. Yeah, he's not going to win. Lemonade's going to win that category, if anything.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
No doubt. Lemonade's gonna win everything.
I hope Lemonade wins Album of the Year.
Did you like that album?
Oh, not only was it like a really good pop album, like for pop music, but it had like, I mean, pretty good messages, pretty good sub things. It had pretty good subtext to the lyrics and like the images and her visuals.
Subliminal messages.
Yeah, like I just really dug everything about it. Like in the fucking music video, dude, it's ill as hell. Like, just every costume, every song, the way it's performed in it is just... It's beautiful, it's scary, and it's just really good. There's no other way to describe it.
I'm gonna have to take a deeper look at it.
Yeah, I think Lemonade's really good.
I listened to, like, 4 songs off the album.
Best song is Freedom, with Kendrick Lamar.
Oh, I haven't heard that.
And there's that one where she's like, they don't love you like I love you. Slow down, they don't love you like I love you. That's a good one.
I heard Sorry. I heard, like... the first couple like tracks off the album, and I was like, oh, that's not bad.
I liked it. I really liked it. But I mean, like, my mom and my sister like make me listen to Beyonce all the time, so maybe I'm just super biased now.
Well, you know what also blows my mind about the Grammy nominations?
What blows you?
Blink 182.
Wait, what?
Got nominated for a motherfucking Grammy for Best Rock Album. And that album sucks a bag of dicks.
Well, how many dicks are in this bag, man?
My favorite band is Blink 182. I love Blink 182, but good God, was California awful. Damn. Oh my God. So poppy, so ignorant, so. Like, John Feldman, who's the producer for that album, like, produces, like, All Time Low and, like, 5 Seconds
like
of Summer
pop,
and, like, all
guy?
These, like, fucking sugar-coated shit holes of fucking, like, oh, my God, it makes me so mad. He ruined the album, but it's nominated. It's their first nomination ever. Everything, up to this point, it was all leading to this point.
Their first nomination ever?
First ever. Enema of the State didn't get anything. Self-titled, nothing.
That's whack, man. Yeah, see, this is why I can't take the Grammys seriously.
Yeah, this is why I hate the Grammys.
Yeah, I guess I still want to go to the Grammys. I still want to get drunk and watch the Grammys. But, like, in the long run,
yeah,
it doesn't mean a dime what they think. Because all these people are making Uber money anyway.
It just, like, it sucks. The Grammys fucking suck. They take songs that are 2 years old and they, like, flash them up for everyone to see.
Like, why is Hotline Bling nominated? Like,
Hotline Bling's nominated. Wait. Stressed Out by 21 Pilots is nominated. That album came out last fucking May.
Well, you wrote about it last, like, fucking May.
Yeah. I literally wrote about the album a year ago. Like, it just blows my mind how, like, how ignorant things can be. Like, there was no good pop songs that came out this year, so they had to revert back to 21 Pilots. Come on.
What are you gonna do, man?
What are you gonna do?
The Grammys don't mean nothing. You know what came up in my Facebook feed recently?
Hmm.
A little something by the name of Spider-Man Homecoming.
Oh, shit,
there's
son!
There's a trailer gonna be released tomorrow.
I'm fucking with that!
Dude.
I'm so excited.
I think they're finally gonna get it right. I mean, I think Tobey Maguire had it a little right. But I feel like they've never really had a teenage Spider-Man, you know?
I'm very particular about my Spider-Mans. Very particular. There's nobody I like better than Tobey Maguire.
I wanted Donald Glover to be Spider-Man.
Wouldn't that be
nice? Oh my god, my roommate will actively believe that you can't be a black Spider-Man.
But he's not, like, racist? Like,
he's not... Well, I mean, all white people are really racist. Like, let's be real. There's no way that we're not racist. It just kind of happens. But, like...
Be careful what you say.
Okay, man. I'll be careful what I say. Everyone who's listening to this, if you're white, you're not racist. You're just a part of a racist system. And you choose to ignore it.
Okay.
That's really what it is.
There we go.
But what are we talking about? Black Spider-Man. You can have a black Spider-Man. Spider-Man was written as a white character, but that doesn't mean his story only speaks to white people. You know? You're telling me there isn't a black kid who likes photography and science who lives in Queens? Like, that shit could be anybody, man.
I think if they're gonna make a black Spider-Man, like, they need to make the first, like, they need to make
the original,
like,
one?
Series
of
Spider-Man. And then spin it off.
Yeah, I agree with
that. So it's like, you got both parties happy. Like, oh, you don't like black Spider-Man?
Just watch your white Spider-Man. He's your racist Spider-Man, right? Just kidding. Just kidding. Not to anger the white masses. But I'm super stoked for that. I mean...
We have some kind of relief because Donald Glover's going to be in.
Yeah, but who is he going to be, though? Like, that's the really big question.
Nobody knows.
Like, some people are thinking, like...
That's why I'm praying that this trailer will reveal
maybe
it.
Like, he just travel to another dimension. That's how Marvel's going with it. They're bringing the different dimensions to the movies, cuz there's like the world 52, world fucking dash 49, like there's like different universes within these comic books full of completely different characters. That's why there's a black Spider-Man in the comic books and a white Spider-Man in the comic books.
Yeah, what's his name? Like, Miles something?
Miles Morales. He's Hispanic and black.
That's so cool.
And he lives in Queens, I think. And he's voiced by Donald Glover in the kids show. Yeah, yes. So there's a little win in that. There's a little tick mark in the good guy column. But,
yeah, there's one tally mark for
us. A billion for everyone else.
This might, like, are you, like, a big Spider-Man fan? Like,
Spider-Man
really,
was
like,
one of my favorite superheroes, man, growing up. But he was everyone's favorite superhero.
Okay, so, like... I was looking at the Wikipedia thing today for the Spider-Man Homecoming, and I didn't see anybody cast as Mary Jane Watson.
I thought it was Zinedine.
No, she plays like a nerdy girl, but her name isn't Mary Jane. It's like some different nerdy like character that like isn't really even like a romantic interest to Spider-Man.
I don't know. She's so hot though. There's nobody cast as Mary Jane.
Yeah, she's playing, Zidania, how do you say it?
Zidania.
She plays Michelle, one of Peter Parker's classmates.
Oh, he's totally gonna bang her.
And then the Spider-Man's love interest is a character named Liz Allen.
I feel like I've heard that before.
Yep, there's no Mary Jane Watson.
Well, I mean, there wasn't a Mary Jane Watson in the other ones.
Yeah, there was.
No, in the fucking, what's that dude's name? He's the second Spider-Man.
Andrew Garfield,
yeah, that guy. There was no Mary Jane in that one.
Really?
No, there wasn't.
See, I totally skipped over The Amazing Spider-Man. Like, 100%. Never seen him. Not interested.
What? I hate it when Wikipedia asks me to donate money. It's like, your website, how much does this cost?
Get out of here. I just want your information.
I'm reading up on my Liz Allen now.
Yeah, she's like...
She's like a nerdy hot girl.
I don't know, like, she's connected, like... Yeah, she's just, like, the attractive,
she's connected,
like,
to the Green Goblin and the Molten Men.
Like, how are you gonna, like, say that, like, you can't change the storyline for there to be a black Spider-Man, but you can change everything else about Spider-Man?
And not have Mary Jane.
Like, there's no Green Goblin, there's no Mary Jane.
There's gonna be, like, six villains in this movie, dude. It's gonna have a lot of villains in it. Because they have to catch up.
Yeah, they do. Well, Spider-Man 3 had, like, a million villains.
Well, yeah, because they thought they needed to make more money. But then in the long run, people were like, we don't like that.
Stop it.
Marvel just has to catch up. Marvel just needs to do the villains right. And because the fucking way they did the Rhino in that third one, in the second one of Andrew Garfield, the second one, the Rhino was just...
Oh, I never saw that.
It was just, neither did I, but, like, the Rhino was just a dude in a robot suit. And that's not good. That's not good. The Rhino was funny because there's a dude in a rhino costume just trampling people.
Yeah.
And I want to see. I want to see that, not the robot.
I think Marvel has a lot of things going for them though, and Marvel hasn't really like had a Spider-Man.
They
movie,
haven't. No.
If you haven't noticed
haven't.
That.
It's on Sony.
Like it's
yeah.
all been Sony Pictures.
You know, after Infinity Wars,
is this the first time?
There's no, gonna be no more superhero movies.
Yeah.
Marvel superhero movies.
What?
Yeah, they're gonna stop after Infinity Wars.
What?
Yeah, dude.
Nuh-uh. They're stopping entirely?
I mean, they'll probably do other shit, but, like, the whole, like, universe that they've built, like, it's ending right there.
What? That's blowing my mind.
Yeah, isn't that crazy? They can just end that shit. And much like the Marvel Universe, after the Infinity Wars movie, which is gonna be fucking wild, by the way. Like, that movie's gonna have, like, 20 superheroes in it. You thought the Avengers was fucking crazy, dog? Nah. Get ready for Infinity Wars, because this is gonna be, like, there's gonna be heroes out the wazoo in that shit. Oh, alright.
What if it's too much, though?
Too much? There can't be too much superheroes. That's like saying, can you have too much weed? Like, you can't have too much weed. It's a great
good analogy. Prime, A1.
Oh, man. But just like the Marvel Universe ending, this podcast is ending. So, thank you for tuning in to the second installment of Northwest by Northeast. My name is Michael Bayless.
My name's Ryan Martin.
Thank you for listening. See y'all soon.